Welcome to a very special episode of the Huggy Poker Vlog. This episode's a little different as it covers my very first live stream showing at the Lodge Live in Round Rock, Texas, which also happens to be my first time ever playing a 2-5 no limit Texas Hold'em. Prior to this, I've only ever played 1-2 and 1-3 no limit, and I can definitely say that I was quite a bit nervous going into this stream. Before we get going, there are some interesting rules in play for the table which impacts the way some hands play and ultimately makes the stream more exciting for the viewers. Rather than trying to explain them myself, I'll leave it to Skull Mike.
It's Magic Monday. 2-5 Hold'em, match the stack format. We are playing the small blind button bonus incentive. So each hand, the button will put $25 onto the button. And if you win the hand from the small blind, you win all the money that's currently stacked on the button. So that's always interesting. Adds a little spice and flavor to the game. We're also playing the deuce seven bounty. So if you win a hand with seven deuce at any time, you're going to get 25 from each player.
And with it being my first time on the stream, let's just see how they introduce me as a new player.
C5 Huggy Poker. I know you were...
Great vlog.
Yep, you were mentioned him to me a couple weeks ago, said he'd be good for the stream. He's been at the Lodge a lot lately, and he's starting his own vlogging experience, so we'll wish him some luck.
All right, and with that, let's get going. The first interesting hand is about 15 minutes into the session when we pick up Ace-10 suited. There's an under-the-gun raise to 20, and I 3-bet to 60 from the hijack. It folds to E in the small blind, who makes a significant 4-bet to $300. I honestly expected him to make a play before the action even reached him, considering the size of the button bonus, which adds a significant bit of value to the hand for just him, and I could see him doing this with a wider range than our holding. Before the cameras can even turn back to me, I ship it all in for a little more than 3x's bet, almost $1,000. He folds, and we scoop our first pot of the night with the power of aggression.
It's really easy when you just have it.
20 minutes later, we've got King-10 suited in the hijack once again. There's one limp, and I make it 20. Five of us head to the flop, which smacks us in the face when we hit top pair with the second nut flush draw. Everyone checks to me, and I came to play aggressively, and I've got no reason to slow down here, so I c-bet for 55. Just E calls, so we're heads up once again to a not-so-great turn of the Ace of Hearts. Given the action so far, and specifically with E just calling our bet with such a large field of players, I'm not too worried about this card unless he has Jack-10 for the turn straight. I think a queen or weaker king are more likely. However, I don't have any reason to bet here to bolt the pot, so I check back when he checks to me. The river shouldn't change anything when it brings the three of hearts. E makes a comment about how much he can bet to get a fold out of me, and when he says that, I'm pretty sure we're good. He ends up checking, and I don't see any value in betting here, so I opt just to showdown, and our king is good. A little bit later, we find ourselves in the small blind with a not-so-great hand, but it folds around to me, and I see there's $100 on the button bonus that I could win here. With that, I open to $20 blind versus blind. The big blind defends, and we end up getting a pretty great flop where we hit bottom two pair. This went from a steal to hoping the big blind has something now, and I lead again for $30. We unfortunately get a fold, but I'm happy to take the pot and even more so the $100 button bonus. Two hands later, we've got queen-10 off in the cutoff. We see a couple limps, and I make it 30 in position. We end up getting two callers, and we hit the flop with second pair. Both players check to me, and I go ahead and c-bet for about half pot, $45. Both players call, which I'm not excited to see, and we head to a turn of the six of clubs. This probably doesn't change anything. I'm guessing we're probably up against a drawing hand, as well as someone who has a pair, a king or a queen most likely. When it checks to me again, I consider checking back here, and probably should have since I've got showdown value, but I decide to stick with the aggressive line for a little more than half pot, making it 125. We get one fold, so we're heads up now, and the river brings the four of diamonds. Our opponent leads into us now for $225. I think on this one for quite a while, and I'm honestly mostly thinking we're beat. Even Skull Mike announces that he can see I'm interested in folding.
Huggy here thinking about making a call with a queen, but I think he's going to get away.
I try to see what other options could be out there though, and the things I'm considering are that any straight draws on the flop missed, and any turn flush draws missed as well. I don't see how the four on the river helps him to make him suddenly want to bet out here, and considering those factors, I end up going with a call.
But oh, Huggy now reaching for chips, and he pays it off. Goes against his instinct. Definitely was telling him to fold, but...
Wonder if that's going to be on his vlog.
Unfortunately, we see the bad news that he had us beat the whole way and rivered two pair, and we're back to about our starting stack again. A few hands later, we pick up ace-8 in the plus two position. I raise to 15, and we get four callers. We get a pretty good flop pairing our ace on a rainbow board. The blinds check, and I lead for 40. We end up getting two callers, and since there aren't too many draws out there other than some gut shots, I'm inclined to believe both other players have a pair. I'm a little wary of someone having a bigger ace, so I go ahead and check on the turn when we don't improve. Sebastian makes it 60, and we see one fold making it heads up. I've underrepped our hand by checking the turn, and I don't think I can fold top pair for this price, so I go ahead and make the call. The river's no help to us, but all things considered, it probably shouldn't help our opponent either. I check once more, and now he bets 125. It's not a very big bet, but considering I just made a bad call on the river with the queen 10 hand, I don't want to make the same mistake twice. If our opponent's paired the ace, then we're behind ace king and ace queen, which I think would have 3-bet preflop, so more realistically, we're just worried about ace jack, ace 10, ace 9, as well as some weaker aces that hit 2 pair. I finally decide that there's enough of a chance that our hand is good, so I put the chips in, and it turns out it was the right call.
And Huggy is going to win this pot.
15 minutes later, I look down at a terrible suited queen on the button, and I decide to make a very aggressive play that should rep a lot of strength, making a 4-bet to $200 after we see a raise to 20 and a 3-bet to 60. Just the original raiser calls, which I didn't want to see, and we head to a flop that doesn't help our hand at all. I bet on the large side again, making it 250, obviously hoping to get a fold, but unfortunately our opponent's pretty sticky and makes the call. If he didn't believe us on the flop, I don't think this turn card is going to change his mind, and I'm thinking that he's probably putting us on overcards like ace-king or ace-queen. Since I'm not expecting a fold, I decide to check back here with the expectation that we're probably going to have to give this one up. That is, until we see a king fall on the river followed by a hasty check from our opponent. If my read's right that our opponent's putting us on big Broadway cards, this board now smashes our range. After thinking on it for a few seconds, I decide to rip it in, and our opponent quickly throws his hand away.
There he goes, all in a snap fold from Howie, so well played. Huggy gets the bluff through.
Almost a half hour passes with nothing really connecting until we pick up 10-7 suited in the cutoff. Howie in the plus one position raises to 20, two other players call, and I up to call here as well. We see a couple more callers, with six of us heading to the flop where we hit a miracle flush. It checks around, and being in position, I think betting here is the right play. We've more than likely got the best hand, and to our opponents, it could very well look like we're just betting with position, which we've been doing all along. I make a pretty sizable bet for $75, and we get two callers. We don't want to see another diamond fall, and we manage to avoid that, though we do see a somewhat scary card as the turn pairs the board with another ace. Dewey, sitting in the plus three seat, ends up leading for a pretty sizable bet of $300 now. I've got no reason to assume he's got a boat, as there are plenty of aces here that could make the same lead, and I'm actually thinking he's probably got a big ace like ace-queen or ace-jack that has a big flush draw to go along with what would be trips. I call hoping I'm still ahead, and the remaining player folds, so we're heads up now. I'm hoping to see a non-Broadway card on the river, and we get our wish when it comes an offsuit 9. Dewey checks, and now I'm certain that my read was right, and we've got the best hand. I decide to make a thin value bet despite the paired board, making it $500. We get a very quick call, I show the flush, and Dewey shows he did in fact have ace-queen with the queen of diamonds.
I like the bet. I'm very happy he did not check behind, not afraid of the board pair, and gets an additional 425. So well played there from the five seats.
Another one for the vlog.
We've got a quadruple straddle in the next hand for 10, 20, 40, 80. It folds to me, and I look down at king 10 on the button. It's not the best hand, but it's not bad, and I've got position, and there's a ton of cash out there, so I decide to stick with the aggression, raising to 200. TJ, who's the biggest straddle, calls to defend, and we head to a 10-high flop, giving us top pair. After TJ checks to us, I make a pretty sizable bet of 250, just hoping to take it down, and we eventually get the fold.
Good hand.
We'll see you later anyway.
Good hand.
The very next hand, we look down at pocket 10s. This is the biggest pair we've had today, and after the under the gun player calls the $10 straddle, I make it 50. The small blind, straddle, and plus one players all make the call, and we head to a flop of king-king-deuce. If no one has a king, we're probably still ahead here. Everyone checks, so I see bet for 75 with that in mind. We get two calls though, and at this point I'm probably either giving up or shutting down. The turn double pairs the board with another deuce, and now even if no one had a king, it's definitely possible we got called by someone who paired the deuce on the flop. The small blind leads into both of us for $125, and this doesn't really seem like an ideal spot to make a bluff. I wrongly give our opponent credit, and he shows that we got bluffed by nothing but ace high.
Good bet from all in Bastion.
Small blind button bonus there.
Takes that nice stack of greenies.
Yeah, that's nice. That's about, that's close to 300 right there that bluff gets through.
15 minutes later, we pick up ace king suited and clubs first to act. I raise to $15, or at least try to, before the dealer informs me there's a $10 straddle and my action counts as a min raise to 20. We see one call before mixing it up in the hijack 3 bets to 90, which I'm not too worried about since I messed up the action here. However, it folds back to TJ and the small blind who 4 bets to $325. What you all didn't see in the livestream is that about 20 minutes earlier, TJ was just talking about how mixing it up always has the nuts. And now here he is 4 betting a player who he's pinning as a solid player who has legitimate holdings when he's involved. Given that, I don't think TJ's just making a play for the button bonus. I think he's legitimately got a pretty big pair. If he's got aces or kings, we've got three outs at best. If he's got queens or jacks, then it's a coin flip at best. Knowing that mixing it up has already 3-bet, I think there's a chance that he's got big Broadway cards, which would be dominated by my hand, but ultimately reduces my number of outs. In other words, instead of having 6 outs 5 times, making this 50-50, I probably only have 5 outs 5 times, making this more like 40-60. I don't think shoving here will get a fold out of TJ, meaning I've got to risk my stack for potentially a 40% chance to win, and this doesn't feel like a scenario that wins long term. Ultimately, to the disappointment of the announcers and everyone in chat, I lay my hand down.
Action on, oh no, Huggy, oh no. Huggy! Come on now, Huggy.
I wouldn't typically fold ace-king here, but I stand by my fold in this specific scenario given the math and odds, despite the flop that ultimately would have favored our hand. A bit later, we see TJ in the plus one seat raised to $15, and I 3-bet to 45 with a suited king. Both blinds cold call the 3-bet, and TJ joins along as well. We get a pretty good flop when it comes two hearts, giving us the second nut flush draw. Everyone checks to me, and I consider checking back, but I've got an aggressive image at the table, and I decide to stick with that image, betting about half pot for $85. We see one call before TJ makes a significant c-bet to 400. I'm trying to think through what hands TJ could be doing this with. Maybe he flopped a set with a hand like 9s, but I also think he could have an overpair with a hand like jacks or 10s given his initial pre-flop raise. Given I've bet or raised on every street, if I shove over the top here, it might look like a bigger pair, and a hand like that might have a hard time calling. If my read is wrong and we're up against something like a set or an overpair that can't fold, we still have some equity to hit our flush. With that, I ultimately go with a shove. It folds back to TJ, who quickly makes the call, asking how many times I want to run it. Since he called, I'm assuming we're behind, and I opt to run it twice. We see the bad news when he shows us he's got a better flush draw, meaning we're drawing to just a king or a deuce. The first run out doesn't help us, so we're still hoping for one of our six outs to pair up on the second board. The turn brings some relief when we see the king of diamonds, but I'm still holding my breath waiting for a clean river, which we thankfully get. We end up chopping the pot in a scenario where we were way behind, which to me feels like a huge win. In the last hand of the night, we 3-bet our suited one-gapper yet again against TJ, who made the initial raise. Just like last time, both blinds cold call our raise, and TJ calls as well. We whiff the flop, but when it checks to me again, given that I've mostly been showing down legitimate hands, I opt to continue the aggression, c-betting for $40. Honestly, I did some bad math at the time, and realized as soon as the bet left my hand that it wasn't big enough. We get two calls, and when we don't improve on the turn, I elect to make a bit of a bigger bet after both players check again, trying to make it look like I'm betting for value. I make it $75 this time, and we do get one fold, but the big blind hangs on, making the call once more. Given the action, I'm putting him on a 6, or perhaps a pocket pair like 7s or 8s, and thinking that if I can bet a bit more on the river, we might get a fold. The river shouldn't change anything, and I go with the plan, making it $175 now. Unfortunately, we get a quick call, show our 9 high, and get shown the paired 6, which is exactly what I had put our opponent on. It seems the price was right for the player, and in the future, I either need to give up on the turn or make my bets more sizable so it's harder to continue for him. One of the exciting things about playing on the live stream is getting to see our stats. You can see we ended up with a chip stack of about 2.4k, though this doesn't necessarily tie to how much anyone won or lost. More interestingly, you can see my VPIP is 40%, which is significantly higher than I expected it to be. I would expect this number to be closer to 20% when I'm playing 1-2. I know the button bonus had an impact on my involvement on hands, but beyond that, I also did come into this with the intention of playing aggressively, and I think the statistics shows that. And my aggression can really be seen in this next stat, which shows I had the highest pre-flop raise percentage of anyone at the table. There were almost no hands that I tried to limp, and if I wasn't calling a raise to join a pot, then I was raising myself. Similarly, you can see that I had the second highest aggression frequency overall. I was in the bottom half of players who went to showdown, which I think could correlate with two possible things. First, if I thought I was behind, I was willing to dump a hand more often than not. Second, I was aggressive to the point of getting my opponents to fold before they could get to showdown. On the last screen, you can see everyone's winnings. We were third in how much we won overall, which is a great feeling considering how nervous I was coming into the live stream.
We did it, guys. We played in our first live stream. We played in our first 2-5 game. It was intimidating getting into it, but, you know, it worked out in the end. We bought in for 1,000, cashed out for, I think it was 2,274, so 1,274 win, which is awesome. I would be excited if I broke even, and we more than doubled up, so super excited about it. Had some really interesting hands, you know, obviously lost a little bit at the end there with a bluff that didn't get through. I didn't expect to get called by the hand that did call me there, but I had put him on kind of a weak hand, which is what he had, just didn't get through, unfortunately. But, you know, lost a little bit there, but still ended up in the end with a nice, solid win. Happy to book it. Thanks for watching. Really appreciate it. I'm going to try to do it again for sure. That was really exciting. I'm happy to go on the live stream again if I can, if they'll have me. Looking forward to it if it happens again, and if not, then we'll just keep grinding elsewhere, you know? If you enjoyed the live stream, if you enjoyed the vlog, please hit the like and subscribe button. I really appreciate it. It helps the channel. Leave a comment. Everything helps out. I love talking to you guys in the comments, so I'll get back to you if you leave a comment for sure. All right. Until next time, take care. Thanks, guys.